1,000 years ago, there were two Gaelic settlements on the River Liffey. Arclea, the Ford of the Herders, and Duvlin, the Black Pool. Then came the Vikings. The Norsemen came first in the 8th century as raiders and pillagers of the Irish monasteries. But in the 9th century, they settled on the River Liffey and made Dyflin, as they called it, a thriving center of trade. Archaeology has uncovered the life of these Norse Irish, the layout of their streets, the remains of their houses, and their wattle walls. Among the finds are the objects of their everyday lives, produced with great craftsmanship. The coinage of their trading system. And their art, with its mixture of the Scandinavian and the Celtic. But all that was to change. Diarmuid MacMurrough, King of Leinster, was striving for supremacy in his region. He turned for aid to Henry II, King of England, whose knights were restless for fresh fields to conquer. So began the Norman invasion. The French-speaking Normans had conquered England a century before and were superior in the arts of war. Led by Richard de Clare, Strongbow, they landed in Ireland in 1170 and took the port of Waterford. There, Diarmuid MacMurrough gave his daughter Aoife in marriage to Strongbow. Then they marched north to Dublin, where Strongbow was met by Archbishop Lawrence O'Toole, and the Normans took the city. Henry II feared that Strongbow would set up an independent kingdom in Ireland. So in the winter of 1171, he came to Dublin with 4,000 knights and stayed for half a year to establish the supremacy of the English crown. Irish kings and chieftains paid homage to Henry, but he still had to deal with his Norman knights. Strongbow was given the lordship of Leinster. Others were given land elsewhere in Ireland. Then, in 1172, Henry issued a charter that granted Dublin to the men of Bristol under the king and made it the principal administrative center of Ireland. In 1192, the city was granted an independent municipal identity, and the names of the Bristol settlers were inscribed in the roll of free citizens. With the Norman knights came the Norman clerics. Henry II had the authority of the Pope to reform the Irish Church. He met with the Irish prelates, and the transformation began. Strongbow and Archbishop Lawrence O'Toole set about erecting a cathedral in the English style of the time. They built on the existing Norse-Irish Church of the Holy Trinity to create Christ Church Cathedral. Until 1871, it was the state church for ceremonial occasions, meetings of parliament, and the royal courts. Appropriately, it is the last resting place of its founder, Strongbow, who lies beside his son. Lawrence O'Toole's successor as Archbishop, the Norman John Comyn, built the rival cathedral of St. Patrick's outside the city walls. For a time there was conflict between the two cathedrals, until Christchurch took precedence over St. Patrick's. The Normans greatly strengthened the defensive walls of Dublin. But King John, who had succeeded his father Henry, ordered the building of a castle. The task fell to Henry of London, the next Norman Archbishop of Dublin, who also became Justiciar, the king's representative in Ireland. The building was completed in 1268, but it kept growing over the centuries. 700 years, Dublin Castle was the center as well as the symbol of English rule in Ireland. In 1229, King Henry III had given Dublin permission to elect a mayor. And the city acquired an official seal for important documents. On one side was a ship symbolizing new partners of trade. On the other, a defensive castle with archers on the towers. It became the basis for the city's coat of arms. In medieval Dublin, only the freemen enjoyed the privileges of citizenship, and they insisted on their rights. In 1316, they succeeded in getting these enshrined in the laws of the city. The Franchise Roll of 1468 lists the names of the freemen. About a fifth were women, but only 5% were Gaelic Irish. Those who wished to trade in Dublin and were not freemen had to pay for the privilege. This was Thomas the Harper. The strokes beside each name show the number of shillings that were paid. This was Walter the steersman. And there was nothing of the crowd. The freemen had full liberty to engage in trade, but they had to be members of a merchant group. Protection within the city walls offered the kind of security in which trade, industry, and crafts could flourish. By the mid-13th century, there were more than 50 different trades and occupations registered. Each guild had its own guild hall for social and ceremonial purposes. This was the Weaver's Hall, now demolished. But the Tailor's Hall survived and has been restored. The guilds had religious duties too, and some had their own chapels. St. Audan's was founded in the 12th century by the men of Bristol. It still functions as a Dublin City parish church. The days of the guilds and the justiciars, when power rested in the hands of a few, are long over. In modern times, everyone enjoys an equal freedom as citizens. But a link with the past remains in the power of Dublin Corporation to confer honorary freedom of the city on Dubliners and others who have achieved high distinction. Since 1876, when the practice was introduced, over 60 people have received this accolade. They represent a symbolic link with the medieval origins of the city.